But in that time, I want you to understand, these moments for us are coming if they already haven't came. And if they came in your life and you're still here to tell the tale, rest assured that the moment may come again. The reaction in that moment, what was his reaction in that moment? Let's look at the text. What did he do?
He turned his face to the wall and he prayed.
Woo! That's how I did. Oh, God, are you listening? God did. Woo! Come on now, Lord. He turned to the wall. It's interesting that he turned to the wall. Turned his face to the wall and he prayed to the Lord. And he said this, oh, remember, O Lord, how I have walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion and have done what is good in your eyes. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. Remember. I've heard that language before in the New Testament. When somebody asked, remember me? Remember me. Mm-hmm. Anybody ain't looking up at me? Somebody said in the New Testament, mm-hmm. God, remember me. It's interesting how things come to full circle. Old and the new. Even the Bible recycles some things because it has to bring back to your memory, remembering. Remember me what I have done. Now check this out. Now Hezekiah, unlike the criminal, had done some things, y'all. And I want you to understand, Hezekiah did some good things. What Hezekiah did was he took the idols out of the temple of Jerusalem, brought back true worship of Yahweh, which is the one true living God, and brought upon religious reform back to the right place. Now, I ain't saying that Hezekiah did everything right, because, again, politically, which a lot of us in church do a lot of times, got himself in trouble politically, trying to align with superpowers, ended up in his demise. The fact of the matter is, what he did do great was he got them idols out of there. He focused the people back on God. See, this is the backstory of Hezekiah. And Hezekiah said, God, I just want you to remember. Remember me. I was wholeheartedly devoted. And see, here's the thing. When you are wholeheartedly devoted to God, the impossible can be possible for you in your life. See, we got to ask ourselves, do we have something to call back to that was wholehearted, true devotion for God? Not that I come to church every day. I'm going to tell you something. Satan comes to church every day. His minions come to church all the time. So I just want to take that one away from you right now. But wholehearted devotion. Underline that. Wholehearted devotion. See, because wholehearted devotion is something different for all of us. We all have different skill sets. So wholehearted devotion for me is not going to be me singing praises. Because guess what? I'm just not a singer like Sister Yen. I'm sorry, I'm not. But if she's devoted and she sings truly with a sincerity for God, that is her devotion. Devotion being her dedication and her commitment to God. Minister Bosby, it's different. Her connection is different for God. She's here faithfully, sets up, comes to church, making sure everything's right. She's praying over this room, y'all. She's braiding the atmosphere, see, because we got to understand, just because we have a church in here, that don't mean the enemy ain't sitting in the seat waiting for us.
That's right.
We got to be praying even before we step in here. That's wholehearted devotion. That's an assignment that God has given her.
That's right.
That's two different walks of devotion right there. So when we underline it, when someone says their wholehearted devotion, you have to make sure you know what is your wholehearted devotion unto the Lord. Because you want to be able to call upon something, you need a spiritual resume.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's important. You better believe you need a resume to get a job. Why do you need a resume to get a job? Say that again. They don't want to see the history of what you've done. No, God sees and knows all. But the fact of the matter is, you need to call upon and look at your own resume from time to time to see your achievements or lack thereof. And you have to say to yourself, what am I putting on my resume? There's a desired position that I want, y'all. And it's in heaven. And I gotta have a resume to submit, because I want to be there. I want to be there. How many of y'all think you can just walk into the company and it's going to give you something? What have you done? And what I love about, see, this is interesting about employers.
Yeah.
They hire you based off what you did somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And believe that if you can do it over there, you'll be relevant and you can do it right here. And that's not really always the case, but that's what gets you in the door. We have to have work and a resume. That when we're praying, you know, I want you to know something. The resume is also for you too. Because our memories are so bad a lot of times. We had some jobs long ago, and we'd be like, I forgot I used to do that. I did have a lot of responsibility. I ain't know it. Sometimes it's good for you to just pull up your resume and be like, yeah, I've been doing this for years. Has it been that long? Oh, yeah, I forgot. I did used to be over a small group and train people all the time. I forgot I could train people and do PowerPoint. I forgot I used to assist people. I forgot I was second in command. I used to be right underneath the executive president on the board and this, that, and something. You'll forget sometimes even about yourself. Life will beat you up. Sickness will happen and occur. Or it will even take away some of your self-esteem and some of your luster. That's what the enemy wants to do. The enemy wants you to forget how powerful and mighty you are when God uses you and when God has placed you. He wants you to forget these things. But Hezekiah, he didn't forget. And it's important that you don't forget. And when he prayed this prayer, this is what I love about this prayer. Have you noticed that the whole month we've been talking about prayer, these have been some pretty short prayers?
But powerful.
But what did you say?
But powerful.
But powerful. They've been some pretty short and concise prayers. They have meaning. They're important. The most important thing that I used to say the first year all the time until I made y'all sick about it, but they were sincere. Mm-hmm. They were sincere. And you had the man of God come tell you, you're gonna die. Get your house in order. You will not recover. And to pray facing away from the crowd. Pray facing away from anything else. Just facing the wall. And when he prayed and said, remember, O Lord, how I walked before you faithfully. Everybody, underline, walked faithfully. Underline that in your book. It might say something different, but walked faithfully. So you should have walked faithfully and wholehearted devotion. And then at the end, underline good in your eyes. Sometimes you got to see these things. Sometimes you got to underline these things. If I walk with wholehearted devotion, do the good in his eyes. Now, whose eyes are we talking about?
The Lord's
eyes. The Lord's eyes are so important. people's eyes are not on you, a lot of times, what do we think when we're talking and we don't see somebody's eyes?
They're not paying attention.
We think they're not paying attention, but he talks about God's eyes because he's trying to say, God, you are paying attention to me. Mm-hmm. We have an attentive God.